You are familiar with jellyfish, those ethereal creatures often seen drifting peacefully through bright blue water at your local aquarium. You may be less familiar with some of their stranger relatives, relatives I'd like to submit for weirdest animal of all time. I'm talking about the Myxozoans, which are microscopic jellyfish-like parasites. And when I say microscopic, I really mean microscopic. They are multicellular, but barely. And some of them, apparently, can also be found on land, not because they washed up on the beach, but because they like it here. So come with me and we'll talk about the bizarre land-dwelling parasitic jellyfish and what we can learn from them. Myxozoan parasites are well known for infecting the skin, muscles, internal organs, and whatnot of fish. Please don't freak out. But also worms and sometimes amphibians, aquatic birds, and pygmy shrews. But let's get back to that in a minute. Like I said, Myxozoans are tiny. They only really have a handful of cells at any point during their life cycle. Some researchers have proposed they even have a very unusual way of forming cells through a process called endogenous budding, which basically means instead of dividing, their cells form within other cells. In fact, at a certain point in their life cycle, one cell is thought to contain another cell that contains another cell in the most bizarre molecular turducken you can imagine. That alone is pretty strange, but Myxozoans are many other kinds of strange too. In fact, they're so strange that for a long time, scientists did not know what to think of them. Because they have a very simple microscopic structure, 19th century scientists thought they were protists. That's a mostly dead taxonomic category, but it would lump them in with amoebas. But that doesn't really make sense because protists were considered to be single-celled organisms, and these guys definitely have more than one cell, just not that many more. They also have stinging structures called polar capsules, which are pretty similar to a jellyfish's stinging nematocysts. While jellyfish use their nematocysts to catch food, Myxozoans use their polar capsules to attach to their host. Stinging structures like these are only present in cnidarians, the phylum that includes non-fishy aquatic species like sea anemones, corals, and jellyfish. These stinging cells are what makes cnidarians cnidarians, so this means scientists were kind of obliged to conclude that the diminutive Myxozoans were, in fact, a jellyfish relative. In 2015, scientists analyzed the genomes of two distantly related species of Myxozoan and concluded that they were sister species of Polypodium hydroform, another cnidarian parasite. Meaning, Myxozoans and Polypodium share a common jellyfish-like ancestor and definitely belong within the cnidarians next to jellyfish. It gets even stranger, though. You could argue that the tiny, primitive-seeming Myxozoans are ahead of their time, like by around 100 million years. This episode is brought to you by this month's presidents of science, McLaren Stanley and Charlie Stanley. How can there be two presidents? Democracy. Maybe we should rename it. Leave your suggestions in the comments. Anyway, thank you both for being so awesome and supporting us over on Patreon. If you, dear viewer, want to learn more about becoming president of science or about one of our other wonderful patron tiers, go to patreon.com/scishow. Like I said, Myxozoans parasitize fish. But here's the thing, they evolved around 651 million years ago during the late Cryogenian, otherwise known as the Snowball Earth era. That snowball was distinctly lacking in fish, which didn't start to appear until around 530 million years ago. So Myxozoans basically evolved 100 million years before the hosts we now know them for. Now to be fair, Myxozoans actually have two main life stages, the actinospore and the myxospore. Fish are an intermediate host for Myxozoans, meaning they act as an in-between host where the parasite develops into a form capable of infecting its primary host. In this case, the primary hosts are annelid worms, the group that includes earthworms. So their life cycle works like this. The actinospore infects fish, and the myxospores develop inside the fish. When the myxospores are released, they go on to infect annelid worms. The actinospores develop inside the worm, and then they go on to infect fish, and so on and so forth. But want to know the really fun bit? Annelid worms also hadn't evolved when Myxozoans first turned up. So it seems like the Myxozoans were only infecting some other kind of invertebrate during that 100 million or so years before they had worms and fish to also infect. Which makes them pretty opportunistic little critters, able to adapt to new hosts and whatever else life throws at them, including, evidently, adapting to life on land. Inside land-dwelling animals, and not just animals that live on both land and water, but entirely terrestrial animals, like pygmy shrews. Scientists aren't exactly sure how they're doing this. After all, you don't often see pygmy shrews frolicking in the waves alongside jellyfish. In fact, one of the places these infected shrews have been found is in Hungary, a nation I feel the need to point out is landlocked. There are no beaches. How are you there, Myxozoans?
One theory is that the Myxozoans are infecting earthworms, which in turn get eaten by the shrews.
Except that pygmy shrews don't eat earthworms very often, so it's not even a very good theory.
And it's not exactly clear how Myxozoans might have made the trip from the ocean to the underground homes of land-loving earthworms, unless they somehow also learned to fly. And or burrow. And although they are pretty weird, there is no evidence of that. Yet.
Kind of the opposite, actually. Rather than evolving brand new abilities, Myxozoans have dumped the genes they don't need while improving the ones they do need. Like a lot of parasites, they have a reduced genome. This may seem a little counterintuitive, but having a reduced genome can be a helpful survival tool. See, parasites don't necessarily need genes for things they can just steal from their host. At least one species of Myxozoan has even rid itself of the need to breathe oxygen. Meanwhile, they've also enhanced some of their genes, such as the ones they need to cope with stress, metabolize energy, and get inside their hosts. Scientists call this mosaic evolution, where different parts of the genome evolve at different rates. It's a type of evolution more often seen in larger animals, like humans and other mammals. Mosaic evolution in Myxozoans represents a departure from the oversimplified traditional view of parasite evolution as a process of genetic downsizing. So these seemingly simple animals are actually helping scientists understand that an organism doesn't need to have a lot of cells to be genetically complicated or uniquely successful. And though you may never admire one drifting peacefully through the bright blue water at a public aquarium, chasing after a pygmy shrew, it's enough just to know they're out there, invisibly evolving in sophisticated ways, finding new species to infect on land and sea.